to believe you are sufficient for me. Why do I talk myself out of a miracle?
Thank you for joining us for worship today. A great way to stay connected to St. John's is through our mobile app. It is there you will find the worship bulletin, connection card, prayer request form, online giving, and more.
Stellar VBS will launch kids on a cosmic quest, learning how to shine the light of Jesus to a dark world. Join our VBS 2023 team that is building an out-of-the-world adventure filled with light years of faith-building fun. Adult volunteers, you must be at least 18 years old. Youth volunteers, you must be going into 7th grade in the fall of 2023 and at least 11 years old to 17 years old.
There are many ways that you can serve in classroom shepherds, classroom assistants for our youth, small group leaders, and more.
Engage.
Our concert series continues on March 26th, with Duraflay's Requiem. And just like all of our concerts here, childcare is available and the concert is free with the free will offering. It's on March 26th, which happens to be my birthday. So, as a birthday present to myself, I get to conduct this amazing work. If you want to give me a present, just show up. That'll be a good enough birthday present for me. So I hope to see you there. It'll be at 7 p.m. on Sunday, March 26th.
It's good to be with you. It's a joy to be your pastor. There's no real secret that something marvelous is going on in our congregation right now. Sunday, Easter Sunday, is going to be something very special. It's a great opportunity to be able to take one of these cards and bring somebody to worship with you that day. I can't wait for us to get together. I stand at the door over there and take that big breath and go, "Christ is risen," and the whole place thunders back. He is risen indeed. Together, we celebrate the hope of the resurrected King, Jesus Christ, our Lord. I hope that you'll join us. I hope that this will take a priority for you. And I look forward to greeting you and shaking your hand and wishing you a happy Easter.
These are just some of the ways to get involved here at St. John's. There are plenty more that you can find at stjohnsorange.org. Thanks again for joining us. Our prayer is that God will open your heart to hear what He has to say. Enjoy the service.
I know, right? The lights are very bright, but that's okay. We want to see your beautiful faces because our fifth grade is here today to help lead us in worship and singing. I know we've got solos and scripture reading and the beautiful voices of a wonderful choir. We are very glad that you are here with us today. And welcome, everyone. It's good to see you. It's good to see you. There is no better place to be on a Sunday morning than right here at St. John's as we gather together to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And today is also a very exciting day because today we are going to welcome new people into our church as they stand before us and confess their faith and say, "Yes, this is what I believe, and I wish to be a part of the body here at St. John's in Orange." So we're just so glad that you're here today to worship with us. You might be wondering, where's that guy who plays the violin? I don't know. He must be over on the other service. He's probably playing over there. Probably got a little bit confused. But I bet if I talk for just a little bit longer, he might just run in at any time. Or, with your permission, I'd invite you to stand. We'll start our service and we'll confess the faith that we share today. And then I know he'll come. Are you ready? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Lord, it is good to be in your house today. It is good to offer you our worship and praise. Lord, it is said that those who love sing. And so today, Lord, we will lift up our voices to sing praises to you. And we ask that the words of our mouths, the meditations of our heart, be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Let's confess the faith that we share together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
That was good. You're right. They'll sing instead. Please take a seat and let's hear our greater sing.
From the fruits of the Spirit. So we invite you as a congregation to job. Great job, fifth grade. Beautiful job. Can we give another hand for these amazing voices? So blessed to have you leading worship. Well, why don't we all stand and let's begin our worship to our Father together. And we're going to sing out this one. It's a glorious day. You guys remember this one? So this is actually our school theme song. And we just find our hope in Jesus as he is raised and as he's died for our sins. So we're going to sing out in our praises with this. I was buried beneath my shame. Let's sing this out. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb. Sing it out, kids. Another huge hand. Can we get Vivian there on the back on the electric guitar? A huge hand. She's killing it. She's killing it. Amazing, amazing. Let's all have a seat. Let's all have a seat. So we're so glad that you're here worshiping with us today. And as we come here every single Sunday, it's a time to reset, to refresh, and to fully ground ourselves with the heartbeat of the Lord. And a way that we can do that is addressing the areas in our lives where we may be holding on to baggage or sin, and give that to the Lord in our own confessions to Him. So why don't we pull up these screens and speak these words of confession together as we come before our Father. So Heavenly Father, we come before you with humble hearts, recognizing that we have searched the world for satisfaction, but it is only through your love and grace that we can find true fulfillment. We thank you for your mercy and grace, which have put power together and satisfy every desire in our hearts. We acknowledge that it is only through your Son, Jesus Christ, that we can find new life and a renewed sense of purpose. We confess that there is nothing better than you, Lord. You are the only one who can transform our lives and bring us true joy and fulfillment. We pray that you would continue to work in our hearts and minds, transforming us into the people you have created us to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as we confess our sins and our shortcomings, we trust in our Heavenly Father's promise of forgiveness and restoration. And we believe that through His Son, Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven and we are made new in Him. And we receive His absolution with grateful hearts and the assurance of your unending love, His unending love and mercy. So today, the good news is, Jesus Christ, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And may this truth fill our hearts with joy and lead us to live our lives that reflect His perfect love and grace for us. And in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. We sing together. Why don't we all stand and we sing this out together?
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fail, are never enough. Then you came along, put me back together. Show you my weakness.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't.
Sing something.
I've still got joy. My firm foundation, the rock on which I stand.
Just the voices.
When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful. So why would he fail now? He won't.
Amen. Won't you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we praise you today as our firm foundation, Lord, giver of life. Lord, we know you will never fail, Lord. And you have gifted us, Lord, with your Son who died on the cross for our sins, that we could be redeemed today, that we can sing out in your glory today. Lord, we thank you for the beautiful fifth grade voices that are singing and praising your name, Lord, as we just build up the church of God and sing out in your glory. So may you bless our service ahead, our days ahead, as we just give you all the praise. We say together, amen. You may be seated.
And at this time, I'd like to invite those who are becoming new members to come forward and join me on the stage as we welcome you and hear your affirmation of faith. All the way up. Well, as you've seen already today, you are stepping into a body of Christ where the Spirit is active and alive and there is a lot going on. But please know that you are much needed, that the gifts that God has given each one of you to encourage and to grow this church and those we serve is why we are here. And so today, we welcome you as new members into our congregation. Friends in Christ, the people of St. John's, your brothers and sisters, welcome you today so that you may walk with us as the body of Christ and find meaning, joy, and community in our lives together. St. Paul writes, but in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. And as for you, you have been instructed and you have begun to walk with this body of Christ that is St. John's Orange. And today we are here to hear your confession and intent to be an active part of the body of Christ, and you have presented yourself today for this joyful affirmation. And so now I will ask you some questions. I ask you as a representative of this congregation the following. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit? If so, please answer, yes, I believe. Do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God and the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church, drawn from them and confessed in the small catechism, to be faithful and true? If so, please answer, I do. Do you intend to live according to the word of God and in faith, word and deed, to remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even unto death? And do you desire to become a member of St. John's Orange and join us in all the privileges and responsibilities that come with such membership? If so, please answer, I do by the grace of God.
I do by the grace of God.
Then here we go. I think your pictures will be up on the screen as well. Melissa Batarse. From Lamentations chapter 3. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Sarah Bright. From Micah chapter 7. But as for me, I watch in hope for the Lord. I wait for God my Savior. My God will hear me. Rory Gamble. Rory from Proverbs 18. The name of the Lord is a fortified tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. Courtney Kay. From 2 Peter chapter 3. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to him be glory both now and forever. Amen. And Lisa Kay. That's you, yeah. You won, I gotcha. And from Psalm 62, truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Truly he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress, and I will never be shaken. Amen. Krista McKinney. From Romans chapter 8, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Zachary Reynolds. From Jude chapter 1, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. And Brittany, we'll work you in at the end. Since you are reaffirming the faith that you've already been confirmed into, we give you this, and we pray for you. Lord Jesus, we thank you that Brittany has joined our congregation and walks with us. Continue to bless her, and may she grow in the faith and love all the days of her life. Amen. Thank you. Natalie Shima. I'll come to you. You're okay. From Philippians chapter 4. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amy Summerson. From 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And Brian Vunovich? From Romans chapter 1, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. Congratulations. And Jessica Ward. Hi. From Psalm 118, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Now receive this blessing. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant you his Spirit, the Spirit of power and love, of strength and grace, and of the Word of God. Amen. We welcome you as one body of Christ. You've heard Pastor Tim and I say it many times in our lessons together. This is your church, your home. And we look forward in hope to seeing how each one of you joins, serves, and loves unconditionally as God has called each of you to do. Will you join me in prayer for them today? Lord God, we witness by our very own eyes your good work in the life of St. John's and with these fine people here today. We pray that you would grant us openness and willingness to reach people with your love and your grace. Grant especially to these new members of the body of Christ a fit at St. John's and lives and habits that reflect your place in their lives. Grant each one of us joy and grace as we walk together in your mission, delivering the restorative hope of Jesus. Amen. Go ahead and return to your seats, and we'll welcome you one more time. And as our new members make their way to the seats, we will participate in something that the Church of God has been doing from the very beginning, gathering together to offer our prayers to our Father who hears them. So let us now at this time unite our prayers, unite our hearts as we go to our Father in prayer to one another. If you're following along with us, you would have gotten the prayer sheet right when you came in. We pray in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ, our resurrection and life, as you raised Lazarus from the dead, keep us from losing hope in the face of death. Teach us to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Give us hearts that are repentant, grateful and loving, faith that is firm and hope that is living. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection put sin to death and rise to newness of life and pass with him through the gate of death and the grave to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of love and mercy, we thank you for the visible gift of grace and baptism, and that your promise is for all people, for households and families, for little children and infants, for all nations. We give you thanks for the baptisms of the Clark family, of Jeremy, Rebecca, Mara, and Madeline. We give you thanks for the baptisms in the Moore family of Ryan, Landon, and William. And we give you thanks for the work of your Spirit in our school and preschool chapels, for the faithful service, witness, and love that our St. John's teachers model in their classrooms. We thank you for the baptisms of Luke James Vunovich in our school chapel, son of Brian and Amy, newly members today. Encourage all the newly baptized to abound in Christ's love, to continually look upon them with compassion and goodness, to keep them in the faith and communion of your church, and to help them grow to be faithful disciples until life's end. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we thank and praise you for those joining the church today, that you have brought to them the knowledge of Jesus and enabled them both with the heart to believe and with the mouth to confess his saving name. May they find the way here. May they find a community that confesses their sins to God, to one another, a home where they can freely find compassion, kindness, and forgiveness, a space to peacefully agree and disagree with one another, a place to be challenged in faith, and a body of Christ where people feel empowered to use the gifts that you have given them to grow your kingdom. May they find truth here, truth found in the authority of God's word, and may they find life here, life found in active worship and participation with the communion of saints. Lord, in your mercy. Sovereign God, where there are sick, infirmed, and afflicted with dry bones, bones that are weak, bodies in need of restoration, we pray that you would breathe your life into them. We pray for healing by name for Stevie Zabel, Joanne Wells, Alicia Vargo, Millie Seaton Arroyo, David Sandoval, Annie Schuler, Zachary Walksack, Sherry, Gabriel, Justin, and Nancy, for Joan Parker and Juan and Maria Garcia, for Evangelina, Ariana, Antonio, for Chuck Ferguson, Freda Gumlach, Faye Janovich, the Ryerson family, the Benjamin family, and the Day family, Sherry Goulon, Mike Stapleton, Karen Teague, Ashley Steele, for Chloe and Gracie, for Matthew and Aaron Proto, for Thea Glenn, Myrna Caceres, Dean Martinez, Denise Wyrick, Mike Farina, Brent Von Baron, Howard and Louise Worthington, Sanda Schluter Huffman, for Patty Zeck Hofford, and those we name in our hearts. We pray also, Lord, with those who grieve and ask that you would give comfort in your prophecy and your promise that you will open the graves of your people. We pray for those who mourn, for Donald Allen Nichols, Papa of Heidi Nichols. We pray that you would bring comfort and peace to those who mourn for Josefina Garcia Morales. And we pray for those who mourn for Hannah McDonald, daughter of Brian and Nancy. We pray that you would fill them with your love and your spirit, and that the comfort of the empty tomb would root deeply in them. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, hear our prayer of thanksgiving for 88 years of life given to Eldon Neben Nabi. Continue to bless him with good health and wisdom. Keep him strong in faith and service to your church. And everlasting God, enable your spirit to live within us. Give life to these mortal bodies of ours, Lord. Govern, transform our minds by your spirit. Bring life, bring peace, and enable us to put to death the sins which poison our body, and instead bring forth a new life of righteousness. In the name of him who is the resurrection and the life, and as he himself has taught us to pray, we speak together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now I believe our fifth graders are going to read scripture for us.
Thank you. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been there, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world."
Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen, a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go."
Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him, but some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests of the Pharisees called the meeting at the Sanhedrin. "What are we accomplishing?" they asked.
Here is this man performing many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in here, and then the Romans will come and take both our temple and our nation. Then one of them, named Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year, spoke up. You know nothing at all. You do not realize that it is better for you that one man die for the whole people than the whole nation perish. He did not say this by his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation, and not only for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one, so that from that day, they plotted to take his life.
All right, hello guys. My name is Alexis, and I am a college student at Concordia University Irvine. And I'm gonna talk to you guys a little bit about the story you guys just read to us. So how are you guys doing today? Thumbs up, thumbs down? Tired, yeah, me too. Okay, I have a question for you. So when was a time that you really, really wanted something and you had to wait a really long time for it? You had to wait to go camping? It got postponed twice? Oh, that's the worst. Yeah. Your birthday. You have to wait 365 days for your birthday every year. So long. Yeah. Christmas. Also have to wait a year for that. Anything else? Maybe you have to wait in a really long line for like a really fun roller coaster. Okay, one more. Yeah. A package. That's exciting. Yeah, great answer. So I'm going to talk to you guys about the story of Lazarus, which is also a season of waiting. And so Lazarus was a friend of Jesus, and he had two sisters named Mary and Martha. And Lazarus was very sick, and so Martha and Mary were really worried about him. And so they go to Jesus, and they're like, Jesus, can you please heal him so that he doesn't die? And Jesus is like, don't worry, he's not going to die, and the glory of God will shine through. And they were like, okay, but Jesus doesn't go yet to heal him. And so he stays where he's at, and over the course of 4 days, Lazarus had passed away. And so then when Jesus came back, Martha was really upset, and she's like, Jesus, if you had been here, you could have healed him. And Jesus is like, don't worry, he will rise. And so Jesus walked with them to the tomb, and Lazarus was in there, and they rolled the stone away, and Jesus yelled, Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus came out of the tomb, and Jesus raised him from the dead. Isn't that crazy? Yeah, pretty crazy. So what's cool about this story is Martha and Mary were kind of in a season of waiting, and so that's kind of what we're in as well. What big day is coming up really soon? Shout it out. Easter. Yeah, Easter's coming, and so we're waiting for that. And what happens on Easter? Yeah. Yeah, Jesus rises from the dead, which is super, super exciting, and so we're waiting for that season. And so there's good news to come, just like the good news of Lazarus rising, right? And so this story is a really good reminder that maybe there are times where we feel alone or we don't think that Jesus is with us or life is really hard, that he's actually with us and he has a greater plan than we can even imagine. And so we just have to trust and be patient in that, right? And so whenever you feel down or you feel like Jesus isn't listening to you, remember that he is with you and he is working and serving in your life every single day, okay? So you guys go ahead and pray with me, and all God's people are welcome to repeat after me. Dear God, thank you so much for giving us life. Help us to remember that you are always with us. And also help us to share that good news with others. We love you so much. Amen. Thank you, guys.
And so this is a very special week for us. Not only do we have the fifth graders singing, we have our new members, but that text is very, very dear to us. And you might have noticed that some of us came late to service, and that's because we have a very special song that we wanted to share with you today. It was written by me and two other songwriters during the summer, and it's actually about this text, about Lazarus being raised from the dead, Mary and Martha from their perspective as well. And we just wanted to share it during our offering moment for you guys, and just let us marinate in that story with Lazarus, Mary, and just of Jesus's miracles that he gives to all of us. So let's come before our Lord as we invite our ushers and take our offering and sing together. I'm so weary of all this fighting, all this death. I've been longing for a moment I could rest. When will it end? When will it end? I've been fighting my battles all alone. I've been searching for a place I'm fully known. And when will it end? When will it end? So come to Bethany, come and set free. Come to Bethany, taste eternity. Come to Bethany, new life for you and me. How about we all go to when he came, his friend was sealed up in the grave. A house of mourning, a house of tears, and for long days. Still he lives, still he lives. Oh, so come. Bethany, new life for you.
Have you ever known a love so strong? Unashamed, you weep till all your tears are gone. Now
sing this together.
When you come to Bethany, come and be set free. Come to Bethany, taste eternity. Come to Bethany, new life for you and me. How about we all go to Bethany?
Amen. Amen. And as we invite our kids to come forward, why don't we all pray together as a congregation? Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for Bethany. We thank you for your everlasting life, Lord. You raised Lazarus from the grave there in that city, in Bethany. And Lord, you give us that same eternal life forever, Lord. And it's through your will that we're made new. You're our firm foundation, Lord, and we build our lives upon you as we praise you. We say together, amen. So we're so glad just to be worshiping with you today. So glad for your children here who are praising and leading with us in worship. And we're just so glad that you made St. John's your school home. And if you're not already a part of our church body, we would love to invite you. We just welcomed our new members today. We would love for the same for you, or just to come and join us on a Sunday for worship. It's, you know, just a testament to the faith of so many people who started off as school family parents here and then got wrapped up in our church and then just got strengthened in the Lord, and they strengthen us as well. We're just so blessed to be such a tight body of believers here at St. John's, and we hope that we could give that to you too. But why don't we give our fifth grade one more applause as they get ready to lead us in worship.
Truth is hard to see when we're
Great job, fifth grade. Can we give him a huge round of applause one more time? Amazing job. Hey guys, you're able to watch that back on our stream. If you want to watch back your kids and hear them sing, you can do so online. It's a great job. Why don't we take the time just to greet your neighbor as we prepare our hearts for the sermon.
Our text today comes to us from the Gospel of John, chapter 11, which was read so beautifully for us by our fifth graders today. They captured a couple pieces from the really two big moments in John chapter 11 in which Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. They read for us that first part in which Jesus and Martha had their conversation, which is just so good. It's what, in a way, our newest members did today. A declaration of faith, in which Martha said that, yes, Jesus is the Messiah. And when Jesus says, I'm the resurrection and the life, do you believe this? She said, yes. And that's not just some conversation about understanding or a theory about Jesus. That is our faith. That Jesus did not claim to have resurrection and life or understand the secrets of resurrection and life. Instead, Jesus said that he is the resurrection and the life. And to know him, to put your faith in him, is to know and put your faith in the resurrection and life that he gives. And I love that question that he asked Martha, do you believe this? And she says, yes. One of the most powerful statements given to Jesus, and it comes in the midst of grief, during the loss of a brother, during the loss when they knew that if Jesus had been there, he could have prevented that death. It's a statement made in hope in the most impossible of circumstances, and Martha does not waver. She simply says, yes. And it's my prayer for each one of us that God would give all of us the grace in those moments to be that strong. And then there comes the second big part of it, when we had the miracle. Jesus calls out to the dead man, Lazarus, come on out, and he did, and you read for us that it had been 4 days, and John mentions that for a few reasons. Number one, because that's how long it had been. Number two, because at that time, people believed that the soul actually hovered around the body still for the first 3 days, but after the fourth, then they were truly dead. Hence the reason there was a smell, hence the reason he was wrapped in linens, hence the reason they buried him. But there's just a blink and you miss it moment in there of when Jesus says, move the stone, that Martha responds. And I love it because even though she had given that wonderful declaration of faith, Jesus still continues to stretch her faith, continues to push her and to call her to act on that faith. And he does the same for us. There's big moments in life. Jesus saying he's the resurrection of life, making confessions of faith, acting on faith, seeing miracles. And this miracle, friends, was the very last straw. Like you all said, Easter is coming, but before Easter is Good Friday. And these Pharisees had had it. They were done with this Jesus. And out of fear of losing their way of life, their temple, their prophets, everything that would come from it, they said, this man must die. And the high priest prophesies and says, it's better for one to die than for all to perish. Truer words could not be spoken, because it is better that our Lord Jesus died for us than all of us would be left to perish in our sins. And I want to talk about those big moments. I really do. They are ripe for messages. But with your permission, there's a little in between. There's a small moment that comes in between those two big moments of that conversation with Martha and before he rises Lazarus that I want to look at. If you have your Bibles open, I'm going to pick up at verse 28. If not, the scripture will be on the screen. And here's what happens in the in between of two big moments. After Martha had said this, she went back, called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said. He's calling for you. He's asking for you. And when Mary heard this, she got up and quickly went to him. And Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. And when the Jews who had been with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. And when Mary reached the place where Jesus was, saw him, fell at his feet, and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." In the in-between moments, a sister runs ahead and grabs her other sister and says, "Jesus is asking for you." In the in-between moments, a sister asks a sister to have a moment with Jesus before everyone else comes and it gets too crazy. And I love what Martha calls Jesus, the teacher. It's that tiny little "the" that's so important. Because among his followers, Jesus was primarily called and described by his teaching activities. He's not a normal teacher. He is the teacher. And here is Martha, a woman, using this term. In that time, the rabbis did not teach women, but Jesus did. And he taught others, fishermen, tax collectors, sinners. You and I. He teaches you and I as well through his word, through prayer, and as Alexis told us in the hard part, through the waiting. For 2 days he waited before he went to see Lazarus's family, which were Martha and Mary. And notice what the sisters both said, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." I wonder how many times they spoke those words to each other. And I wonder how many times we find ourselves speaking words similar. Asking questions like, "What if only, then this wouldn't have happened." The questions of why and what if only in the silence of this, or in this case, the waiting, are difficult. Some of us have learned by experience that God's silence in the face of our question is not due to some inadequacy in ourselves, some glitch that we didn't live right or pray right. Or if we could just get the words right or stop sinning, then these bad things would stop happening. God's silence or waiting is very common, and it is repeated for all who are alive and especially for those who follow him. That's why I think when you read through the Bible and you see so many examples of it, and especially in the Psalms, there's so many prayers like, "Why, Lord, do you stand so far off? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble?" Or, "How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts, day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will the enemy triumph over me? Or, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, I find no rest. Why? How long? How long, if only?" We ask these questions quite a bit. And I don't know if we will ever get an answer. But the significant things for those who will follow Jesus are that we will keep on praying, keep on trusting, despite the silence, despite the waiting, even despite the results. And why do we do it? Because we know who God is and what the heart of God is. That God does not hide himself, but has shown us who he is in Jesus. That even when our eyes show us one thing and our minds play tricks on us, our heart stays rooted with the promise that Jesus is with us always. He is the God who saves, the God who holds on. He is the God who cares. Look at verse 33. When Jesus saw Mary weeping and the Jews who had come along, because, at the time, the people who mourned the Jews, they would weep out loud. They would shed great tears. They would cry hysterically. The more unrestrained their weeping, the more honor it paid to the dead person. But when Jesus sees them, he's deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asks. They say, "Come and see." And then the shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. And the Jews say, "Look how he loved him." But some said, "Couldn't he open the eyes of the blind? Couldn't he have kept this man from dying?" To the mind of the ancient Greek at the time, the primary characteristic of God was apatheia, the inability to feel any emotion whatsoever. The belief was in an isolated, compassionless God, a removed God who did not care. But that is not the God of our Bible. That is not the God who truly exists and is there. And it is here in the in-between, in the little moments, the moments that each one of us experience, the death of loved ones, the pain, the sorrow, we see that the grief and the tears of Mary and Martha moved God, moved Jesus, that he sees the tears of the grief-stricken and he is moved with compassion. This means that for each one of us, God sees the tears that we cry. That he is touched by our tears, that he remembers our tears, that he is actively working to dry our tears, and there will come a day when we will cry no more, for he will remove them forever. And don't miss that he is deeply moved in spirit and troubled. This is a remarkable phrase. With the modern versions here, we see that deeply moved. Our modern ears think that this is like a touching sympathy. But what actually this is an anger, an indignation about what the devil had been able to do in this situation. That he had caused such pain and hopelessness to ones that Jesus loved. And that when he sees the pain of the sisters and even some of the crowd and the realization that they thought Jesus could have saved if he was there in time, but there's nothing he could do now because he's dead, this deep anger and indignation rises within him, moves his spirit, and troubles him. And I think this is important because when we are faced with the effects of the devil's work of destruction and death, we can be drawn like they were to confusion, to hopelessness, to this deception that God has turned away from us. And I don't think that happens in the big moment. It happens in the little ones very slowly in the days that follow. It happens in the in-between. But it's here in the in-between that the Lord Jesus' response came and connected to those who were weeping and cried. And he moved close because he cares for us and will stop at nothing to undo the havoc created by the evil one and the work of death. That he will go even to his own death for us so that we will not experience true death. We will not experience the separation from God, but we will experience and see him face to face. For he alone defeats the devil. He alone has broken the power of death, its sting, so that even when we die, we are alive with him. Which is one of these reasons I think John points it out. And there's a contrast between weeping and wept. Jesus was moved and grieved, but he wasn't out of control. It was a quiet weeping. Because as he wept, he was staring at the tomb, at his enemy, death, right in the eye, knowing all along what it was going to cost to destroy this enemy, but not stopping. Because those shortest little tiny verses right there, Jesus wept, that tiny in-between one shows that he was our God, that there is no sin or shame when we cry in our grief. It shows us that Jesus is not away from us in our grief, but he identifies and comes close to us in sorrow, that he loves us and is present with us in every moment. He is the one who shares in the grief of those who mourn. And you better believe he is the one who does something about our grief. Which is why this little section of see how he loved him, could he not have? The questions don't ever go away, friends. We are always going to find ourselves asking how long, why? Is there something else I could have done? The same words that Mary, that Martha, that the Jews, that each one of us asks. Words that we will ask on this side of heaven. But God gives us the strength to respond just as Martha did. Even now we will believe. Even now when we don't understand, we will trust. Even though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though the waters roar and the foam and the mountain quakes with their surging, in death, in sickness, in pain, in whatever is before you, we do not fear, for God is our refuge and strength, our help in all times. That's what you have in the in-between. We all remember the big moments, the cry of faith, the miracles, and we have to, that's part of life. But do not ever forget that in every moment, in the in-between, there is one who is with us. There is one who gives us hope. There is one who gives us love. One who gives us peace. One who gives us life. That's our message for today. That he is with us always. Even in grief. Let's stand together and sing our last song before we leave today.
In this last song, we celebrate. We celebrate that new life that we have in Jesus, that Lazarus found there in Bethany, and that we find. So we know the Spirit is always dwelling with us. And so as we sing out this last song of praise, let's just give thanks to God for this worship that we get to sing to him, the voices that we get to join together. So let's praise together.
The Spirit of the Lord.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Spirit of the Lord that dwells with us. Lord, we thank you to be able to praise you, Lord, for the firm foundation you have set for us. Lord, we know that this world is not perfect, and we know the trials that we face. But Lord, you provide the foundation for us to go forward. So we thank you for the family that you built us in, Lord, which is the family of Christ. So we thank you for your worship today. We pray in your heavenly name. Amen. Now we're going to invite Pastor Trevor up as we receive the Lord's benediction.
Our Lord bless you and keep you. Our Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give to you his peace.
Amen. We want to invite you back to Good Friday, to Easter, and we want to see you around. So please come up and talk to us after service. Enjoy the rest of your day, and thank you for worshiping with us.
Cheers.